Hopefully everybody's found the right place. I noticed that as soon as the sec def was done with his talk, about 600 people bailed out. I was frankly a little surprised that we have this many people here for the afternoon session. I do note that the front seats, it's kind of like the front pews in church. They must have kryptonite or something underneath the seats. Or it's always tough. My name's Robert Thomas. I'm not going to spend a lot of time teeing this up because I really want to get to the panel members. And when you look, I think everybody's got a program, and the lineup card we'll use is Jim Lukeman, then Frank Morneau, Lorin Selby, Jim Newman, Eric Thompson, and then Steve Spear. The we can keep going. Next slide. That's an ugly-looking character up there. So as how many people out there have read A Design for Maintaining Maritime Superiority? Okay, that that quick survey is surprising to me that many people, A, have read the document. We rolled it out in January of this year, and it is really nested with a cooperative strategy for 21st century sea power. As you look at the design, since most of you have read it, there are four lines of effort called out, and three of those look very traditional to all of us. It doesn't matter whether you're in industry, you're an international partner, or you're in the Navy Marine Corps team. Very traditional one, you know, is kind of platforms, one's people. In fact, people, I think, is going on next door with Bill Moran. And then partnerships, and Chris Aquilino's been heading up that effort. And then there's this fourth line of effort that says, you know, achieving high velocity learning at every level. And for most of us, that's been it's a bit of a head scratcher. Robert Thomas is in charge of implementing that line of effort across the Navy. And I'll tell you that for the last 8 months, it has been a bit of a struggle to make sure that I'm on side with where we want to go with this. But I think the CNO has characterized it probably the best way possible, in that, as the design states, for the first time in almost 30 years, the United States Navy and the Marine Corps are facing potential peer competitors in the maritime. You know, for the last 30 years, we've been, you know, operating, you know, just essentially in a benign environment, sitting off people's coasts, running sorties inland without much interference. That has obviously changed. CNO's proposition is that our combat advantage is eroding when you look at those potential peer competitors. And in the future, we won't necessarily have more stuff. We will qualitatively have better stuff, but that combat advantage is thinning, and that it's an existential competition potentially. And so what is it that's going to give us or allow us to restore that combat advantage that we've frankly grown used to? And the proposition is that learning faster, learning more effectively, making decisions inside the potential adversary's decision cycle, that is probably where our advantage is in the future, that we can truly exploit to get this kind of exponential performance growth. And he is adamant that we need that exponential growth. He sees it in commercial applications. You see it in places like Silicon Valley all the time. You know, if we could just map over kind of venture capital mechanics to the United States Navy instantly, it would probably, our performance curve would be that much better. But we are going through this cultural change. In fact, Jim Newman, one of our panelists, will point that out, and others, I'm sure, will touch on it. So there's the proposition, is we've got to learn more effectively, learn faster, make decisions inside the opponent's decision cycle, to increase our performance in a nonlinear fashion. If we don't make this cultural change and we just keep doing business as usual, and I think Lorin Selby said it best, he said, we'll just keep using 20th century processes to try to get after 21st century problems. And that's not gonna hack it. So with that, I'm gonna turn it over to Jim Lukeman, and then we'll kind of go rapid fire down the line. They'll present remarks, and our goal is to provide enough time at the end for some tough questions from you, because frankly, this group, industry, our international partners, the rest of the people in our own organization, you're gonna help us navigate through this notion of high-velocity learning in the future. Thanks.
Okay, yeah, it's working. Thank you, sir. So you can hear me okay with the microphone right now? Good. Okay, yeah, I'm Jim Lukeman, and I do training and education for the Marine Corps. So my portfolio is from everything from recruit training through all the MOS skill progression training in the Marine Corps and professional military education, then just general training. So it's training and education. We've put it all under a command called the Training and Education Command, which is where I work. So thanks, sir. So I'm going to dive kind of down into some practical things here in a minute that the Marine Corps is doing, I think, that fit this kind of high-velocity learning construct. But first, I'll talk a little bit about the Commandant's guidance to us and how that lines up with some of the same things CNO is saying. You know, we don't use the term high-velocity learning, at least we have not, in the Marine Corps lexicon. But when you look at what CNO is saying about what high-velocity learning is and what the Commandant is giving us in guidance to do, very similar. Okay, both talk about innovation and creativity and trying to develop leaders and organizations that are innovative and adaptive and willing to change. The Commandant specifically talked about having leaders who are innovative and willing to implement change in his planning guidance. They also both talk about some of the changes that we're seeing in technology and kind of the exponential growth of that kind of thing, the whole singularity is near business and the changes we've seen in computing power and artificial intelligence and nanotechnology and a lot of things like that, and being able to look forward and harness some of that to implement in our training and education continuum. So that's our challenge from the Commandant, is to have a 21st century training and education continuum that produces Marines that are in this organization of the future. Same thing as what the CNO is describing, I think, with different words. So before I get into that, let me talk a little bit, one anecdote from we had an innovation conference down at Quantico a couple months ago, and we brought in folks from across the Marine Corps, but also brought in folks from outside the Marine Corps, and had a couple days just to think about how to improve innovation in the Marine Corps. It was put on by our Marine Corps Warfighting Lab, which are kind of our forward thinkers. So one of the projects they did was they broke into groups and they came out and they briefed back on the groups. And I was listening to one of the group brief backs. And the tactic they took was to say, well, what would an organization look like if it was resistant to change, if it was resistant to innovation? How would you design an organization like that? And they said, well, you'd probably want to make sure that they were very, you know, hierarchical, and it was pretty clear, you know, what the rank structure was and who was senior to who in there. And they said, then you'd probably go out and recruit people, bring them in. You'd send your best people out to go get other people and bring them into the organization. And then you'd probably start them off, you know, indoctrinating them into the history of the organization and the ethos and values of that organization, so they were fully immersed in that. He said, if you really wanted to get extreme, you could make them all wear the same clothes and cut their hair the same way. And so as the Commandant and CNO talk about unleashing change and creativity, we've got an organizational construct in the military, which a lot of people would describe as exactly opposed to that type of an organization. So it's a challenge. So diving down, like I said, into a couple of concrete examples of how we've tried to go about this. I'm gonna talk about one, and it's called the Squad Leader Development Program. So Squad Leader in the Marine Corps, the Marine Air Ground Task Force is kind of centered around an infantry unit. The infantry unit is centered around the squad. 13-man organization with a sergeant is the squad leader, and that's who's in charge of that organization. So the challenge for us was to create decision makers in those squad leaders with the skills and experience and education to do what they have to do in an environment today where the actions they take are gonna be discussed worldwide within a couple hours. So how do you create that individual. So again, it's a sergeant. Sergeant usually has between 4 and 10 years in the Marine Corps. The way our manpower process had worked with reenlistments, a lot of times when the person is making sergeants, about the time they're leaving their first assignment with the infantry and going off to do something else, like be a recruiter or a drill instructor or something else. So we had to figure out a way, one, to fix our manpower process and then create this individual. So it started with identifying the talent. So we asked our division commanders to go find those young, promising 2 and 3 year Marine corporals and lance corporals that have the potential to be squad leaders. Identify those guys. We'd pull them out, meritoriously promote the corporals to sergeant, send them to school, both their professional military education, the sergeant's course for PME, and then the tactical part of the education, our squad leader's course, and then we'd send them back in for another, they'd agree to reenlist and go back in as a squad leader again with that additional education. And we further took that squad leader piece, the tactical education for them, and broke it apart, because we wanted to take the tactics, techniques, and procedures part and teach that at one level. That was things like how to emplace a machine gun and how to call for fire. We wanted to build those skills separately. And then we created a course called the Infantry Small Unit Leaders Course, which was purely a decision-making course. And so you put all sergeants in there so that they're all the same grade. And then that course, 6 weeks, was really a series of decision-making exercises for those guys. So this was our bid to create, pull out the right talent, give them the education and training, and then put them back into our squads as an experienced leader. So we're in year two of that right now, and in keeping with this learning organization do loop of, you know, execute, look at how, assess, you know, come back and plan it again, we're making some adjustments in second year for additional incentives. Because you might imagine some folks aren't all that thrilled about going back into the infantry for another few years afterwards. So we're working the incentive piece to make sure we get the right people into the program. So that's called the Squad Leader Development Program, kind of a tactical way we're getting at changing our talent at the Marine Rifle Squad. I talked a little bit about this technology business, and pretty exciting times with that. So I'll talk about one example of another thing. That kind of is a technology-focused initiative that we've got in the Marine Corps right now. ONR has been working for a while on something, and they've recently transitioned it over to our program manager for training systems, and it's an augmented immersive team trainer is what it is. So those of you familiar with mixed reality, virtual reality, augmented reality, that's what this device is. So it's a training device that'll enable us to train better, faster, cheaper, and really just better. So the idea, it's an augmented reality thing, similar to a Microsoft HoloLens or Magic Leap, for those of you that are on the cutting edge of that. How many people have an Oculus Rift right now or have it on order? Okay, a couple of you, that's good. See, I don't either, but we got two guys in the office that do. And so that's the virtual reality thing. But the AITT is an augmented reality. So in this one, it mixes real world with simulation. So it is a device you wear on your head, but if I was wearing it, I could see you all. And then I can also drop constructive things into that environment. So I could put enemy in the room, or I could drop rounds on the room, or I could bring a Cobra in here and do a strike. So this trainer, what it allows our Marines to do is to do combined arms and maneuver in a way that is very realistic with live forces, but you now can bring in combined arms without the risk, without the cost of actually conducting the live air or the live artillery. So this is an example of how tools, if we get the right type of technology that Marines can use, can enhance the training we get. So how does this fit into the whole, you know, high velocity learning idea of an organization that is innovative and willing to change? And I think that example is one of embracing technology and what the future will bring us. It's really exciting to see what just 5 years from now or 10 years from now we will have in the way of changes to our learning and our training and education systems, our training and education technology. So keeping our Marine Corps University and our training group, again, a lot of Marines and civil servants who've been there a long time, doing things the same way for a long time, and getting them to be receptive to and accepting of the new technologies and new ways to do business in a way that'll make us better and faster, that's one of the challenges we're working through. So happy to talk more about education, training, or anything related to either of those when we do Q&A, but that's what I wanted to say up front. Thank you.
Good afternoon. How's everybody doing? Too loud for anybody in the back? Can I get a sound check? Thanks. Hey, my name is Frank Morneau, currently assigned as the commander of Navy Expeditionary Combat Command. And I want to build a little bit on what General Lukeman said as well, too, in my pitch. But, you know, I'm pretty fortunate. I have a great job, and my job is not to necessarily come up with the good ideas concerning high-velocity learning. But I'll put it to you this way. My job's to put a beating heart into it. So there's 19,000 sailors out there, numbers of units of action. And when they go forward, how do, as we talked about the sergeant's course, how the Marine Corps is learning at that level, how do we ensure that we're stratifying the high-velocity learning at all levels across the commands that are inside of my TICOM? Now, we've all heard, if you're in this room probably right now, you've heard the CNO say we have to learn faster. And I know Dr. Spears probably heard him say a number of times as he's driven us, we have to learn faster. Now, I go back to that beating heart, and where it applies to us is the fact that we have to, just as we talked about and DNS said in his opening remarks, we have to learn faster than the enemies of our country, okay? Whether that's a peer threat or in some of the cases of some of my forces, a terrorist organization that's on the ground, we still have to be fast enough from technology, from acquisition, to being able to plan, implement, assess, share the ideas of what we've gotten from that high-velocity learning, and then get our lessons learned and plug them back into the system to ensure that we are defeating the enemies of our country in combat. So we took an approach to implementing the design to our forces, and that was breaking it up into combat effectiveness. Now, combat effectiveness, the way we are defining it, comes back to really one thing. We will continually learn every day faster than those of our perceived enemies of our mission of what we have to do. That said, we broke combat effectiveness down into two parts as well. Combat power, which is stuff. You know, there's a lot of stuff, I think, in the rooms below us right now that we're going to go look at that all applies, the technology, et cetera. And I was worried about that, sir. I didn't know if I had to get penicillin for the intraocular device that you were talking about for a second. But the stuff is important. But where we're really putting our money right now is into fighting power. And fighting power, the way we define that, is building the culture that we have manifested in our design for maintaining maritime superiority with every one of our sailors, from the young E1 that just comes out of boot camp to the old E08 that's necessarily getting close to retirement. All across our force and our spectrum, we have to make sure that everybody is learning and implementing at a high degree. Now, how do you do that? How do you do that with a culture? You make everybody understand that part of what you do every day is your desire and your commitment to be the best. Doesn't matter what your job is, doesn't matter on your level of responsibility, but it involves making sure that the fighting power, the commitment to excellence, the commitment to being the best you can is institutionalized throughout our force. We've got to give people, as you probably heard, we're going to talk about it, you've got to give them the opportunity to fail. Last week, we did an airfield damage repair operation. First time in the history of the Seabees, which came around since 1942, and our mine and bomb disposal forces, which are EOD, since 1941, where they actually did it together. What they learned was they didn't have the C2 right. This was from day one to day two. They needed to know how to necessarily assess all the craters, how they were going to plow all the craters, how they were going to render safe all the bombs that were in all the craters. So it goes back to getting young sailors out there, letting young sailors necessarily get after things and determine how they can, in fact, learn on the fly, and learn in what? A decentralized operations environment. If we go back to one of the greatest warriors of our generation, General Mattis, what did he come up with? You got to be able to operate in uncertainty and thrive in chaos. So fighting power is driving exactly that, just like General Lukeman talked about. We're working on the Mark I motto brain, and we're making sure that that decision process and how fast that we can get after the decision process is built inside of our sailors and how they process information and they can use the new technologies and go forward. So I got two slides. Let me show you some other, can you pull those up real quick? Slide number one. So what this is, you know, we are nearing the end of our surface mine countermeasure ships, our airborne mine countermeasure ships. But what we did, we took current off-the-shelf technologies, unmanned vehicles. We teamed them up with an EOD platoon. We teamed them up with some of the experts down in Stennis, Mississippi, who know how to read sonar. And we built a unit of action called Expeditionary Mine Countermeasures. It combines all of those forces together. It utilizes all of this equipment, and it takes it out to the field. And it's a singular unit of action that can do what? can do the entire find, fix, finish, exploit, analyze, disseminate, and attribute to who did the operation at the same time when we come down to the mine countermeasures. Now, where I think the beauty of it comes to with high-velocity learning is we're not tied to one Mark 18 underwater vehicle system. The next piece of technology that comes out can be plugged into this. The next thought that comes out of the young sailor, who if you look in the one that's in, I guess it's the 3 o'clock position in the Hollywood Squares, it shows a little rubber boat there. That's where they came up with a way to tow a 900-pound underwater vehicle 12 miles out to sea in Chinhe Harbor. Now, it usually takes two EOD technicians to swim that thing out to sea. That's a joke, folks. One could do it. Thanks, Admiral Selby. But my point is, all of this is being generated from your fleet. It goes back to building that culture of how we have to stay ahead of our enemy and how we have to operate and thrive in a decentralized environment. Next chart. Bunch of IEDs, all real pictures, all pictures from the battlefield. Well, and I'll give Joe DeGuardo credit because he's in the audience today, one of our captains, because when he was a young officer in Iraq, he came up with the SEXI. Now, you don't want EOD guys coming up with acronyms as well, too, but that stands for Combined Explosives Exploitation Cell. What was happening to us? We're trading bomb for bomb on the battlefield with our enemy. Not a peer enemy, but an enemy that's taken a $20 bomb and creating a weapon of strategic influence, a roadside bomb. When we buy $20 billion in MRAPs, I think it's become a weapon of strategic influence for us to conduct combat operations on the ground. My point is, by creating that cell, we were able to take the forensics off of all of those weapons and get it back into the system, provide the intelligence, provide the exploitation, determine where we needed to prick the targets, and attack the bomb makers in their labs, vice wait till we were attacking the bombs while they were out there on the road. And the interesting picture's in the middle, but I don't think you can get it. It's a cell phone, actual ID, and if you can see it, it says missed call. So my point is, as we went through utilizing technology, utilizing, again, a culture of rapid learning to defeat our enemies, I think we were able to get ahead of this threat and save lives on the battlefield. So I look forward to questions as well, too. I think, as General Lukeman talked about, real practical application here where we're having to go. But I think the important part to this remains the culture. You know, Bill Walsh, I think everybody in the room probably knows, one of our most famous football coaches said what? If you can create the environment to develop learning, the score takes care of yourself. So thanks very much, everybody, and I'll pass it over.
All right. Mic three.
Hey,
all right, you got me?
Lorin, yeah, check it again.
All right. Yep, looks like so. All right, got it. Okay, afternoon. All right, who here is from industry? Raise your hand. Okay, how about any academics in here, any UARCs? Okay, got a couple academics. And I see a lot of government. I see a lot of, obviously, military. So kind of like the CNO yesterday, that's kind of the team we need to solve the problems we're talking about here. We got some very challenging problems. You've heard everybody from the CNO all the way to the SECDEF talking about the fact that our technological advantage is being challenged. And in some cases, we may have been surpassed in certain areas, okay? And that should concern all of you. I know it concerns all of us at this panel. So what does that mean? That means we've got to do something different. When I saw Admiral Richardson about a year ago, before he became CNO, we had a stimulating conversation about what the future of warfare looked like. And he said, well, what do we have to do? I said, we have to think different. I said, like Steve Jobs, think different. And he said, what does that mean? I said, well, that's the hard part. I said, we've got to do things faster. So a lot of this stuff is really about getting better at what we do faster than anybody else. And that could be a unit, that could be an individual, that could be an entire organization. It really doesn't matter. But we've got to change, Frank said it, culture. A lot of this is cultural stuff. Before I go on, I'm going to show you a really quick video because I want you to see kind of some of the threats that I'm talking about and also some of the opportunities. Can you cue up the video, please? It's a quick 2-minute video. Thanks. Okay, so got your attention? Okay, a lot of threats out there, but also a lot of opportunity. You see that exponential curve of technology increasing? I mean, a lot of folks have heard me say this, but there's a great book called Second Machine Age, and it talks about this exponential rise in technology that kind of started back in the late 1700s when James Watt perfected the steam engine, and it kind of goes from there to where we are today. And it's actually phenomenal. I mean, the pace is not slowing down, folks. In fact, if you just look at the internet, by the year 2020, there'll be 37 billion devices connected to the internet. 37 billion. By 2025, between $3 and $6 trillion will be added to the economy because of the Internet of Things. $3 to $6 trillion. That is not small change, folks. That is a significant percentage of our GDP. That is huge. That's where we're going. And we've had some great discussions the last day and a half here about connecting systems and sensors and shooters. Well, it's kind of already happening in your pocket. We just have to figure out how to translate that into the DoD. And that is the challenge. And so part of what I wanted to talk about today are what are some of those things that prevent us from going faster, prevent us from doing these things like just taking those technologies and bringing those into the Navy or the DoD and using them. And clearly there are a lot of rule sets out there that tend to slow us down. Folks in industry here, it always comes up, acquisition is too slow, DoD 5000. Look, think about it this way. So things like technology increase at an exponential rate. Things like economics, legal systems, contractual systems, acquisition systems, social systems, those tend to increase at an incremental rate. And that's why I like to say that we're playing a 21st century game with a 20th century rulebook. The fact is the rulebook has just not caught up. And it probably can't unless we change the rulebook. And that's kind of where I think we need to go. But that said, we have to operate under the systems and the rules and laws that we have in front of us today. And there are ways we can become, there are authorities that are available that we just tend to not use because we're not used to using them. Things like other transaction authorities, things like partnership intermediary agreements, things like establishing consortiums to look at different research areas. I mean, there's things that can be done. We just have to be more creative. We have to push our contracts folks and legal folks a little bit out of their comfort zone. It's not illegal, but it's just not what they're used to doing. We have to try to push those folks in that direction. So as I look at these systems, these things that we need to try to change, I mean, if at an organizational level, Frank talked about some of this, but there are a lot of things that get in the way. There's stovepipes. Sometimes there's classification issues. Sometimes for good reason, but sometimes it's just because. These different systems and sets of rules and criteria that have just been allowed to build and build over time. As the SecDef said back at lunch, they're kind of cumulative. And so over time, you go from a bill that was 500 pages to a National Defense Authorization Act today, which is, I don't know how many pages. It's a huge book. It's probably, several thousand pages. It's a lot. But the bottom line is these things tend to accumulate. You bring these things on, but you tend to not shed these things over time. And that's where we have to stop and really look at these things and try to figure out how we evaluate that. So if I wanted to go faster, next slide, please. If I wanted to go faster, I'd want to put in place systems that would allow me to think differently. It would allow me to kind of open the white space. And so a lot of what we're trying to do as we talk about high-velocity learning, it's challenging ourselves, challenging our organizations, and trying to allow folks to challenge the assumptions. And I would say with data, because if you can provide me data, I can go in and I can challenge someone with some rule set and say, hey, look, I've got data that shows that if I do something differently, I can still satisfy whatever criteria I'm trying to satisfy, but I can go faster. So that's a lot of what I'm trying to do, what we're all trying to do here on this panel with high-velocity learning, trying to challenge the assumptions, put in place different rule sets that allow us to go faster. If you look at the slide, I mean, there's a lot of things up there. White space on the right there, that's a huge part of what I think we need to try to establish for ourselves. If you look at human-machine teaming, we're getting to a point today where technology is going so fast and we're inundated with so much data. It's just data. I mean, we don't even know how to handle it, so much information. You have got to use machines to help you parse that and help you decide on what to act on and what not to act on. And what that buys you, it buys you decision space. It buys you the ability to actually make a decision as a human being. Because at the end of the day, the technologies that we gain, our adversaries are going to get them too. If they don't get them first, they're going to get them within a few years of us getting them. So the years of having, you know, a 50-year advantage over the adversary like we had in the last century are over. At best, we'll be a decade or so in advantage of the new technology. So the real deciding factor between nations that have the same technology really comes down to the human mind. Comes down to the mind. So if we can find ways to free ourselves just enough decision space to make a better decision than the adversary, then that better decision will win the day. And that's kind of where we're trying to go. And so high-velocity learning is everything from an organizational level where you're trying to break down barriers, have people think differently about problem solving, trying to get teams to attack problems in different fashions to try to get their organizations moving faster, to actually doing things faster, like fielding systems faster, prototyping systems. So instead of going off and spending millions of dollars on an acquisition program, let's go test it first. Let's give it to the warfighter. Let's let him or her tell us what they think about it before I go lock in the requirements and then go spend millions to try to build these things. These are the kind of things we're trying to do. So there's a lot to this, but again, as you look at the barriers, a lot of it, folks, is look in the mirror. It's us. It's us. And again, we need to challenge ourselves, challenge the assumptions. And if you can build data and come in with a reasonable explanation of why you think something will work better with a different rule set, then show us, and we'll try to go challenge those rule sets. So I look forward to your questions, and most importantly, I look forward to helping you help me help you and all of us solve these problems, because it's going to take a team sport, and it really is going to take folks that are maybe not immersed in the problem every single day to come up with some new ideas, but I'd love to hear them. Thanks.
This one's still working in the back? Still okay? I find that I also have to approach this topic in a nonlinear fashion. It's difficult yet simple because there exist pockets of HVL in every organization, but not uniformly, not comprehensively, not top-down. I call it micro HVL. I've done it myself. I've seen it done by others. Others here have given examples of micro HVL, but it is definitely not widespread enough in most organizations to be the whole shebang. True organization level HVL. And why not? Well, we all got to where we are, and we all consider ourselves successful. So whatever we did, how we do things must be okay. Many of us come from organizations that do parts of high velocity learning, HVL, well. For example, I grew up at NASA. For my space flights, we trained micro HVL. We designed, improved, shared knowledge, and developed problem-solving capabilities. The motto of NASA's flight control was, "In God we trust. All others bring data." But when it came down to it, we allowed both Challenger and Columbia to occur because we were not a true HVL organization. We normalized performance deviation from technology that wasn't working as expected. Columbia was my generation's opportunity to try an Apollo 13-style rescue of a fatally crippled space shuttle, but we weren't even given the chance. We didn't go get the data. But the need for such heroics is the mark of a non-HVL organization, because foam strikes had already happened too often. Turns out a piece of foam had come off on my previous flight 3.5 years earlier than my last flight, and we are starting to build the International Space Station. But that piece of foam didn't hit the wing. High value, high risk operations such as NASA or the Department of Navy are really in need of the HVL culture. But existing cultures are hard to change. Culture requires a common language and common assumptions and agreements about reality. The challenge is to add in an HVL culture to the naval services' existing cultures. For HVL to be successful in the Navy and Marines, we all need to speak the same language. Specify design to capture existing knowledge and building tests to reveal problems. Swarming and solving problems to build new knowledge. Sharing new knowledge throughout the organization and leading by developing these capabilities in our people. Phrases from High Velocity Edge. Credit Steve Spears. Another one, and these phrases all need to come trippingly off our tongues. No team can design a perfect system in advance. Wow, What does that say about procurement requirements and RFPs and contracting and development? And our systems are only getting more complex. But now may be the right time to embrace HVL as part of the CNO's design for maintaining maritime superiority. The Naval Services and DOD are involved in a lot of culture change right now. And we actually need an HVL attitude to help us manage the change that is here and that is coming. We need to leverage this change for good. For example, women in the military and the opportunities that should present us. We know that having diverse groups at the table results in better outcomes. How do we take advantage of that? Conventional warfare is changing. Can nation states with nukes really engage in serious conventional warfare with each other? So what are the threats? We need a long-term perspective. We know that the civilization of young men is an age-old problem. What are the new perspectives? Here at home, there are now more young women in college in this country than young men. But the education of women and treatment of women in many countries leaves room for improvement, to say the least. The treatment of our military women by our military men is a real problem. Recall Susan Brownmiller's 1975 study entitled Against Our Will, Men, Women, and Rape. It is not the whole story, but rape is perhaps a statement of power more than anything else. Even the language we use in the military should be considered. Of course we all support the warfighter, but are there other words that are appropriate as well? Peacekeeper, or ally builder, or some such that acknowledges the full scope of what we want our military to do for us. The concept of leadership, followership, and expedition behavior could also be integrated as part of the HVL culture. Excessive emphasis on any one of the three, too often leadership, can be counterproductive to HVL. We need not just leadership, but we need HVL leadership. So how can we HVL our way, design, improve, share knowledge, and develop problem-solving capabilities to evolve our military culture, to keep up with the changing world we live in? The military culture will evolve, but talking about it with HVL language should help. We also need to acknowledge that high velocity does not mean overnight. It may take years, but we have to keep plugging away. At NPS, we had a serious IG problem 4 years ago. We have been digging ourselves out ever since and just completed a successful IG, and he's here in the room, it turns out, that we hope will restore trust by the Navy in NPS's culture and our value to the Naval Services and the Joint Force and DON and DOD and interagency civilians and our international partners. We have embraced a culture of compliance while working hard to maintain a culture of innovation. As part of our corrective actions, the amount of training required has gone way up. The financial processes required for audibility have grown substantially. Contracting has slowed down to reduce risk of mistakes. And even our burgeoning legal staff are overwhelmed by the sheer quantity of documents to review for legal sufficiency. We thought we're getting special treatment, but have learned from our students and colleagues that this is happening throughout the Navy. The dean of our Graduate School of Information Sciences termed this as living in a low-velocity bureaucracy, or LVB. So we need to learn and implement HVL throughout NPS, the Department of Navy, and all of government, really, to overcome the LVB, HVL in an LVB, because otherwise, at some point soon, we fear we'll be completely compliant and auditable, but we'll find it very difficult to get anything done. And as another part of the CNO's initiative, we hope that whoever is working on line of effort three, this is two, yellow, number four, balance administrative requirements. Hurry, please. What does HVL mean in an educational environment? I've been told that the Navy has problems with acknowledging the value of advanced education for its officers. But for many officers, apparently the risk is worth it, and NPS is one of the options for those officers interested in any of a number of choices for a master's or PhD program. NPS grads end up with a higher promotion and retention rate than those without a graduate degree. Many at NPS would argue that they are doing HVL already, especially in their research, exhibiting where competition is immediate and tough. But though exhibiting some of the hallmarks of HVL, most of what is happening is most likely micro-HVL. Teaching methods in particular could, I believe, be improved by a systematic application of HVL. Clearly, there are costs associated with HVL, but the products are so valuable and the competition for students so keen that it is in our best interest to apply the HVL concept, to improve teaching and research. And by explaining the concepts and reinforcing the language to our mid-career joint officers, we could spread the word not only to our naval officers, but to the joint force as well. So how do we begin? Next slide, please. Start small, solve a problem that really matters. Don't think too much, but do a lot. Start with a small footprint, but a long leg. That means from the top down. Stay safe. Don't wait until you have enough free time, because, of course, none of us do. Thank you.
Well, good afternoon. It's my pleasure to be here today. It's tough to follow some of these highly experienced leaders and some of these great minds. I looked up at the stage here and saw what we call in football an unbalanced line. I first thought that was uniform versus non-uniform. Then I realized the line would be more balanced if I just dropped back into pass protection and let these guys take care of it. But in spite of that, I'm gonna talk to you about high-velocity learning. And I'm gonna, being known sometimes as somewhat heretical, and perhaps that's why I was invited to this panel, I would argue to really create a high-velocity learning organization, we need to stop thinking about it as high-velocity, and we need to stop thinking about it as learning. Okay, let me talk to you about why I think that's the case. First of all, we think about velocity, and we think about one of two things: doing stuff faster or doing more things in the same amount of time. And I would argue that high-velocity learning is not actually about that. It's about generating an outcome where you increase your performance in a shorter period of time. So it's about performance outputs. It's not about speed of action or speed of inputs. The other thing is high-velocity learning isn't just about learning. We have a tendency within the military lifelines to think about learning as something that happens in educational institutions. We think about learning and education as happening in training environments, and that's part of the problem. There are challenges in our training and education and learning environments, and they could benefit from high-velocity thinking, but if we relegate our concept of how we change the military to what happens in our training pipelines, we are never going to bend that performance curve, and we are going to delude ourselves and thinking that we are actually learning. So when I think about what it's going to take to become a high-velocity learning organization, what I first look at is the default setting of the Navy, our Marine Corps brethren, the Department of Defense writ large, and what I see is a modus operandi that values unity of effort, hierarchical chain of command, standardization. The gentleman down at the end here releases probably more Navy instructions that everybody is supposed to follow than anyone else. And it's about process and process control, and often how something gets done is equally or even more important than what the product of that is. And so when we're talking about high-velocity learning, we're talking about a cultural change, which is a challenge for any organization, especially an organization with a deep-seated culture that grows its people through training pipelines, that uses doctrine, even if it uses it in a half-assed fashion like the Navy sometimes does, that sort of environment, strong traditions, which is a powerful force for keeping unity within the organization, but not a powerful force for change. We have service ethos and command environments, and we have a Secretary of Defense who, just a few years ago, when he was Undersecretary, was famously quoted as saying, "I always say, don't do cultural change, it's too hard." So what are the key components of the high-velocity learning culture that I think it's important for us to keep in our frame of reference, and then think about what do we do about instilling it? First of all, it's a questioning ethos. It's about empowerment at every level to experiment, learn, and change. It's about swarming to problems, discovering root causes, and adjusting processes rapidly. It's about challenging boundaries of what is considered possible. The CNO is all over this, if you've heard him speak at any time in the last 6 months. It's about discipline and thinking about what is known and what is not known, what can be tested, and how knowledge can be developed and disseminated. And it's about a commitment to share knowledge outside your unit or your organization and to seek lessons and knowledge and a knowledge base from others before you try to solve your problem in a vacuum. It's about template. It's tempting to say that the Navy already does some of this, and the gentlemen to my left have actually given some good examples. But when we look large at the Navy, we say, Navy reactors, almost zero problems, a rigorous investigation problem. If anyone has been involved in naval aviation, the debrief after a flight is frank, brutal, and implemented in every stage. But that's okay. But there, I think, at the cultural level, there are broad inhibitors to the Navy becoming a high-velocity learning organization. First of all, one component of this is the no-fault, zero-defect posture towards people in terms of their career progression and the performance evaluation of organizations. We tend to take a lanes in the road approach for dividing responsibilities by organization. They're the training people. They're the requirements people. They do concepts. Test and evaluation, that occurs over there. We also have the desire to standardize practices and have process-centric approaches, particularly in staff activities. We see some pressure on that in the operational environment. The MHQ MOC, the Maritime Headquarters Maritime Operations Center initiative about 8 years ago, was an effort to, in the operational environment, get out of the strictures of the Napoleonic codes and push staff elements together that actually are synergistic. I haven't seen that reflected in headquarters, and I haven't seen that reflected in staffs across the Navy or our Marine Corps brethren. Programs, acquisitions, strategies, initiatives, including the design high-velocity learning as a concept, span well beyond the tenure of any officer or any enlisted person in their particular area of responsibility. So this culture of, well, I'm not going to fix it effectively in my period, I don't control all these things, why don't I check out, why don't I just do my job and worry about it. As I've walked around the fleet and talked to senior leaders and junior leaders across organizations, operational commands, headquarters, shore establishment, I've come to recognize what I see as sort of three bins of reactions to the idea of high-velocity learning. And that is people who really try to get into and embrace this concept and figure out what it means for their organization and how they can begin to change their culture. That's the most interesting bin for me. The second is those folks who do everything they've been doing so far and adopt the language of high velocity learning or the design for maintaining maritime superiority. It is so tempting in the culture of the military to say, okay, what is my organization? What do I do? All right, let me map back to CNO's words. You know, pick your words, whether it's Admiral Greener, now pick your words, Admiral Richardson. And as long as I can put on my slide a couple of those pieces of language, then I must reflect the ideals and the ethos that the leader is looking for. That's part of our culture. That's part of what we do. So how, and then I guess the last piece of the problem, I think, is this set of barriers, and it's cultural, it's organizational, to sharing information across organizations. I heard some of these guys tell some really good stories, and I think it's really strong building blocks for a foundation of, what am I doing within my organization? How do I look at the problem set of mine countermeasures and improving? What do I need to have in there? My technology, my people, my training, my ranges, that's all great. But what is that doing for the aviation community? What is that doing for staff functioning in OPNAV? Where is that getting into the concepts development people who are doing that? We don't do that yet. We don't do that well because your chain of answerability, how you're evaluated, your competition between your peers so you can get ahead and be recognized, all mitigate against that. So it's a pretty tough environment to create this cultural change towards high velocity learning. So what can we do? Well, I'll give you some of my thoughts. And I was sort of putting together this big bag of observations, ideas, and things that I've learned along the way, I was trying to figure out how do I organize an idea about how you might start to get after this problem. And so I went into some of the Harvard Business Review literature, because I learned from reading his book that there are a bunch of smart people that I'd never exposed myself to before I came into contact with high-velocity learning. So I'm trying to do a little learning with a small L and not much velocity. But there was a great article that came out that said cultural change, it was entitled Cultural Change That Sticks. And the authors offered five things that you need to do to create real stickiness to cultural change in an organization. The first is to match culture and strategy. That is, you must match the audio and video of what you're doing. You have to explain why we need to change our culture, not just describe the culture you want to see. So for the Navy, I think that's leaders talking about not only the what, but the why. It's about strategic documents aligning behind the core concepts of how the Navy should operate and conduct its business. It's about signaling the intent to change culture by changing organization where necessary, changing players where necessary, and changing the POM, that overarching document that everybody knows we're serious if it ends up in the POM. The second is focus on a few critical shifts in behavior. And to me, I think two easy ones. One is applying what the CNO calls the learning engine. If you've heard him talk in the last couple of weeks or months about this, this is a frame of reference where you say, okay, when I have a problem, I'm going to look at the problem, I'm going to define it, I'm going to define the environment in which it operates, I'm going to make a hypothesis as to how I can change that environment, I'm going to build a plan, I'm going to execute it, and I'm going to evaluate, build a plan, say exactly what change I expect to induce in the environment, I'm going to execute it, and I'm going to evaluate the degree to which that happened, and continue that process over and over again. Another piece is, a command environment, whether it's in a staff or fleet headquarters or a single unit, for knowledge sharing outside the organization. As long as you focus on keeping what you learn, no matter how high the velocity is inside your organization, you are not creating cultural change. The third is to hone our strengths, honor the strengths within your existing culture. And to me, there are a couple of pieces in the Navy culture. One is the devolution of authority under C2, under combat conditions. We try to push down decision-making to the smallest unit level possible. We don't do that in staffs, and we don't do that in our offshore-based institutions. We do a lot of deck plate learning. That's great. It happens at unit level, at the ship level, but it does not change the way the Navy works. The fourth is integrating formal and informal interventions. This is what I call a coalition of change agents. Somebody here needs to be building a coalition of change agents to carry the message in formal and informal environments so that people come to understand and they can map mentally what high velocity learning will mean in their organization. And finally, we need to measure and monitor cultural evolution. This is painful. This is unnatural. It's like, you know, it's like the body rejecting a mismatched organ after an implant for the Navy. It's squishy, but we must do the hard work of evaluating what we are trying to do, whether we are getting the change that we want, how we can judge whether that is sufficient, and when we decide how to change, implement, or be satisfied with what we've done. I think those are some of the pillars to bring capital H, capital B, capital L into the Navy and Marine Corps team. Thanks.
Okay, so when I hang out with Eric, you can tell he equates high-velocity talking with high-velocity learning. That's why I get lost. Okay, Steve, to wrap it up.
All right, thank you. So, unbalanced line, I'm the guy on the end. I've spent probably the better part of the last 20 years trying to answer one question, and another 20 I may get to a good answer, but the question goes something like this. Which is, at least in the commercial sector, you have many, many contestants in each of the same games. And those games might be consumer electronics, autos, whatever else it happens to be. And for a variety of reasons I'll detail, you would expect a pretty level playing field to lead to pretty much parity and outcome, and that's simply not the case. It just isn't. There's a huge skew between those who are best and everyone else. And it may not be surprising that I'm the bow tie wearing guy from MIT to say that the secret sauce here is learning, but it's learning. And I want to be really specific about this. It's not just learning, I'll detail what I mean by that, but it's converting everyone in an organization, and not just the folks wearing white lab coats, but the folks wearing coveralls and the folks wearing hard hats, converting all of those people into bona fide knowledge workers. Where even the most heavy industry has behaviors which you would associate much more with Silicon Valley than the Rust Belt. So anyway, let me offer some color commentary and detail, just in terms of the complexity and some of where you can and can't get competitive advantage. So Toyota, and I'll pick autos because I've got long history in that industry, Toyota's facility in Kentucky, it's about $5 billion invested there. It's got 7,000 people. Round-the-clock operations, huge complexity of equipment and machinery, so you've got engineers and technicians constantly doing repair, maintenance, upgrade, replacement, that kind of thing. And it all exists there to launch, as it were, a new product at the rate of half a million units per year, so that's more than one a minute in round-the-clock operations. And when I told my Toyota friends I was coming to speak to the Navy, he said, remind them that the stuff we launch, we have to build first. So anyway. And the plant itself is not a standalone, right, because it's got the supply network, and I don't even say supply chain. It's this huge degree of interconnectedness which spans all of North America, goes to Asia, and bridges over to Europe. And so you have to keep all those pieces moving in some kind of harmony so you get this launch rate of about one every 45, every 50 seconds. Now, here's the other caveat on this, is that with respect to the vendors in the room, you can't buy anything that actually matters. And what I mean by this is if you go downstairs, there's a whole bunch of gear which you can buy if you work for the United States Department of Defense. And the folks downstairs, if they want to sell it anywhere else, they have to get permission. Not so in the auto industry, that anything you buy, steel, aluminum ingots, plastic pellets, the equipment on which you give shape to that stuff, your vendor will sell it to everybody else. You buy a subassembly off the Toyota line, let's say, there's the Chrysler, the General Motors, Ford line. So there's nothing you can buy that you may need it to get in this game and stay in the game, but you can't differentiate yourself with that stuff. Anyway, that's the setting for this. Now, here's the thing. Given the complexity of the environment, the fact that when you launch a Camry, an Avalon, a Lexus into the competitive space is running against the offerings from Ford and Hyundai and Kia and all that, you would expect parity. And that's not the case at all. So in the auto sector, when Ford sells a car, they make about $900, $950 per unit. General Motors, Chrysler, they're way behind on that. And Toyota's at 3X. They make about $2,700 per unit. And to get this down into a little more micro level, the Camry, which has huge amount of competition, has been sales leader in its segment for the last 10 years. Digging down a little bit further, same problem, much different result. So the world auto industry recognized the problem of increasing fuel efficiency, reducing emissions. And everyone had to use the same technology to get to that answer, you know, reduce the weight of the automobile, go with a hybridized system, so on and so forth. Chevy came to market with the Volt in 2010. They've sold, I don't know, about 70,000 copies. Toyota beat them to market by 10 years. I mean, 10 full years. And whereas the Chevy Volt is about 70,000, 80,000, 90,000 copies, Toyota's hybrid systems, it's now in the sixth generation and on some 20 different platforms, they're up to 7 million copies. So there's a difference of 100 to 1 in terms of success into the same hostile marketplace. So when you take that situation, parity and complexity, parity and suppliers, parity and challenges, and you know huge discontinuity in terms of outcomes, it gets down to the learning story, which is, you know, if your team and my team are playing the same game and you repeatedly kick the stuffing out of me, now you think about our starting point is equal, right? We're both ignorant in terms of what the market needs, and we're both fairly ignorant in terms of what will satisfy those needs. And we certainly have no idea at all what the configuration of the systems are that will meet those needs. Yet you keep kicking the stuffing out of me. It means that you go from the same starting point of ignorance to a much deeper knowledge than I have, which means that you're constantly challenging what's been accepted in terms of what we do, how we do it, how we train up on it. And you're constantly challenging that and looking for new problems and new answers. And let me just conclude. The word culture has come up a lot across this table. But this learning thing, it's so outrageously countercultural that if you can figure it out, it's a huge advantage. Because if you think about what happens in organizations is that we get to an answer, right? And then we start training on the answer. And we have an accepted answer, skills, an accepted purpose for those skills, an accepted method of training on those skills, and we reward and promote and acknowledge on how well people do what's already accepted. And what we're saying is that if we really want to learn, what we have to do is ask people to challenge what's accepted, always asking the question, well, you know, is that the right skill with the right purpose transmitted in the right way? So it's wildly countercultural. That's a departure. But let me just offer this, is that if you're asking people to behave in a way which is wildly countercultural, for all the words we can put about empowerment and engagement and this and that, you can't reasonably expect that this will bubble up from the bottom unless there's air cover from the top down. And if this question is answered, you're curious, I can give you some sort of tangible examples of that. But, when I read the CNO's strategic design, and he talks about, you know, near peers and regional competitors and the asymmetric disruptors, that rang true from the commercial sector, and that you can't buy stuff that'll give you advantage. That rang true, and then it's really about people and everyone, regardless of their garb, becoming knowledge workers. That also rang true, and it just struck me, it's really, really hard to do, but the one thing that had me encouraged is that I was reading a document from a flag officer in the United States and not somewhere else, because we're kind of committed to this whole notion of everyone created equal, and that you actually have a right to stand up when you want to challenge them. You can put your soapbox in the town square and stand up and call it out, and if people actually agree with your disagreement, they can gather around it. No one can do anything to disrupt that. And fundamentally, I think that's our competitive advantage, because not so many other folks have made that commitment to those truths about equality and the right to disagree. Anyway, that's my story.
Hey, Steve, thank you very, very much. I think you put a nice kind of capstone on what was a great series of presentations from my perspective. As I said, I'm trying to implement this for the CNO, and each one of our panel members, I was taking notes and saying, okay, I can plagiarize that, I can plagiarize that, in an effort to get into bin one, as Eric talked about. Okay, I'm going to turn it over. We've got about 15 minutes for questions, and just go ahead and use the microphones. Go ahead.
This is a question primarily targeted at Dr. Speer. So the first thing I learned when I left the cushy home of academia and was thrust into the cold reality of industry and later government service is that there's actually a really, really good way to change culture, which is that everyone does exactly what you incentivize them to do. And we have the ability, we can give people more money and we can give people promotions to incentivize them. Now, if we want to incentivize people, if I want to incentivize my team, for example, to become better high-velocity learners, the best way to do that is to have good metrics for are we learning quickly or doing, you know, performing high-velocity learning. So I guess my question, which is primarily directed to Dr. Speer, is what are the metrics that we can use to say are we getting it or are we missing the mark?
Oh, yeah, thank you. The question about metrics is a difficult one for me to answer because I'm the guy at MIT who's not quantitative. So, but let me offer this is that when we look at organizations, at least in the commercial sector, which have made profound change in behavior, right? And fundamentally, I think culture is a reflection of consistent behavior given common stimuli, that it's not obvious that incentives, monetary, and other kinds of recognition do the trick. Actually, the places I'm familiar with, Alcoa, Toyota, Intel, and some others, it's paranoia that's been, and leadership cultivated paranoia, that unless we change, we're sunk. So we can't be complacent. And it's almost like an inoculation against complacency. And I'll just give you some small examples of that. So in the case of Alcoa, they had these crazy results in terms of making Alcoa arguably the safest employer in the country, despite the hazards of their industrial processes. They just started building up the paranoia around, well, do you really want to show up at work and leave with one less hand? No, I don't. So why don't we see problems about that? At Toyota, they built paranoia about, well, we're a small auto company in outside of Tokyo in a small, insignificant economy. Do you want to lose your job? And Intel also, Andy Grove, wrote a book called, you know, Only the Paranoid Survive. So I think it's the cultivation of paranoia and the fact that there's actually a burning platform gets people to change as much, more than so, the fact that there's an established system of accepted rewards for accepted behavior. Now, in terms of the other metrics, this is the countercultural part, right? So the accepted things we do is questions. How well are you doing at learning skills which are accepted in an accepted fashion for an accepted purpose? And the countercultural thing is, what have you discovered that doesn't work? And what have you discovered about why those things don't work? What have you discovered that might work better? And so I don't know actually how you measure that, but you certainly can see it in the language, the behavior, the posture of leadership, and the resulting change in language, posture, and posture and language and behavior of those being led.
Yeah, I think some of the other panel members want to jump in. Frank, why don't you take a swing and then Lauren?
Yeah, so one other thought on that. So what I found is when you're trying to change culture in a large organization, usually if you have a leader who's got who's passionate, who's got strong, who can put out a vision, is very articulate about that vision, usually you'll get the senior leadership will buy in because they're with that person daily and they kind of will get that. The very junior people will also buy in because they still want to change the world. They're kind of trying to come in. They really want to make a big difference. The problem you get is there's a clay layer. It's kind of in the middle. And you guys, probably a lot of you folks have seen this. And that's the hardest ones to change. And you've got to really reach those folks. And it takes really persistent leadership to do that. And you've got to really reach down and communicate. Quite frankly, you've got to reach through the levels. You've got to try to reach each level, but you've also got to just use the top and the bottom and try to drive it and try to bring those two together and then convince those folks in the middle that, hey, this is really right. And Stephen's right. If you've got a compelling, you know, emergency national need that this company is going to go under unless we all change kind of mindset, okay, fine, that will also help you. But short of that, you really have to get the top, you got to get the bottom, you got to keep working those folks and be persistent. And over time, you can change it, but it takes a great deal of perseverance.
Yeah, on the Navy staff, we talk about that middle group as the permafrost. So go ahead, Frank.
Yeah, I want to pile on a little bit, too. I think, you know, we're talking about the design, we're talking about the lines of effort. We're measuring it. I go back to, you know, how do you measure fighting power? It's this big nebulous thing out there. Well, that's what he thinks. Well, that's baloney. There's four words in that design that come out to how we should be measuring our culture and commitment: integrity, accountability, initiative, and toughness. And I think the way that design, our design, right, not CNO's design, the way our design in the Navy articulates those words and how we're getting after those core attributes really articulate, are we changing the culture? Are we moving the needle in the positive direction so we as professional warfighters can do our bidding for the country? And that's what it's got to be. I can't put a monetary cost on it. I mean, my son's a United States Marine, second lieutenant. I can't put a cost on what he costs to me, but I can put a cost on those values is where I would go.
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
Yeah, I'm with SAP Software. The Army Training and Doctrine Command down at Fort Eustis is planning an ACAT-1 program called ATIS, Army Training Information Systems. They're going to take the schoolhouse applications and move it to the cloud. Is the Navy planning on something like that, of moving to the cloud? And they haven't made a decision yet whether they're going to do this at DISL or at an Army data center. But is the Navy Marine Corps planning something like that for some of their schoolhouse training?
Well, I'll start with the Marine Corps side. I'm not sure the Navy, well, you can probably talk from MPS. Not specifically moving to the cloud. I mean, what we've done is leverage some of the technology that is out there now and future technology. So things like Blackboard and the ability to network to access MarineNet is our network for distance learning, for instance. So outside the classroom, the ability to access MarineNet from anywhere and make it easier for Marines to then connect with it. And the folks down at the university are moving forward with some of the same things you see in universities across the country in terms of getting away from, you know, written material and being able to provide learning environments that are more interactive and more responsive to student requirements as they learn. Putting things on videotape and reversing the sequence of instruction to where you learn first and then come to the classroom to discuss and exchange ideas with others rather than coming to the classroom to hear a lecture and then going home to do homework. So I think trying to leverage some of the current stuff, but I wouldn't say specifically moving, I don't know, honestly, if we put things in the cloud or how we're doing that, because I know it's all kind of linked via Blackboard right now for us.
Yeah, so on the Navy side, and I'm gonna turn it over to Frank, I'll give you an example. We haven't moved it into the cloud. The CNO would like to be there today. We're just not agile enough. But to that point of injecting technology and then trying to run and catch up with it in a learning environment, in a schoolhouse environment, we ran an experiment with recruits at Recruit Training Command up in Great Lakes. This was really our Master Chief Petty Officer of the Navy who said, hey, let's give this a try. Why are we having people learning basic skills? You know, we handed them iPads. You know, they can watch YouTube videos on their own, rinse and repeat as much as they need to get those basic skills so that we can spend the classroom time getting after that deeper learning. And they noticed about a 20% speed increase as far as attaining those basic skills with these 500 recruits that, you know, we put them on iPads and made it more interactive. Frank's team down in, I think it's Panama City, your EOD school.
Yes, sir.
So here's a bunch of people, you know, in the bomb squad, that same technology inject using some what, you know, our children would consider basic, you know, digital skills and tools has increased their learning rate significantly so they can get after either more material in the training pipeline or shorten it up and we get more, as we call it, A sub O out of Frank's team downrange because we're shortening up that training pipeline. So baby steps compared to what you're talking about, which is a more holistic training effort for the soldier, but we are scratching at that. One of the things that Steve points out, where this kind of gets exemplified, is you look at the difference between Toyota's onboarding process and their initial training for manufacturing, you know, in their workforce versus a GM. And already you can see that that cultural change, that learning change, starts right in the onboarding process. So that's why we're going after it at the recruit level. Yes, sir. Okay, now I'm in trouble. One of my mentors has just shown up at the microphone.
Mike Vitale, former Navy, now KPMG Consulting. You all have talked about very eloquently what high-velocity learning should look like and how we might get there. But in the end, as you all know, we have to change behavior. And changing behavior requires changing rule sets, which is what Admiral Selby mentioned. So I'd like each of you to tell me one rule you could change if you could be king for the day. In the
Admiral,
way that we are doing behavior today. And then Admiral Thomas, if you would, tell me how we are planning on implementing those potential changes, if you're thinking, and I know you already are, thinking about doing that. Thank you.
Thanks, Admiral, for putting us all on the spot. So what we'll do is we'll just go down the line and kind of look at a rule, and then I'll try to put a bow around it, because that will be the last question, I guarantee it. Jim?
That's a great question, sir. You know, and I kick myself for not having thought about the answer to that beforehand, so I'm trying to figure it out on the fly. I think a rule that would allow us to access the best of what's going on in commercial industry right now more quickly to apply to military applications. I know we talk about acquisition rules a lot, but in some of the things that we want to apply to the learning environment, training and education for the Marine Corps, there's an awful lot that's going on right now on the commercial side that we can really take advantage of. So changing a rule that allows us to more quickly iterate with industry on the things that have the most promise to us. And so that's not a simple rule, but it's a desire that'll help us get where we need to go more quickly. So I got fortunate to be the first one to answer
yeah,
the question.
Thanks, Jim, for taking one for the team. Frank?
Thanks, sir. I think the challenge rule in the NFL is probably the one that I'm not at all comfortable with. I'm going to pile a little bit on General Lukeman here. I worked at GIOTO for about 9 months, and I think we need more fiscal flexibility with some of the way that we can apply money to do exactly what we're saying, to either speed some of the technologies, and I say again, to remain ahead of our peer or near-peer competitors. But we had three-year uncolored monies where I was able to apply seed money into something that, guess what, it could fail. And if it failed, you know, that was the price of trying to beat the enemy at his own game. So I think we need that type of flexibility. I know I've said a number of times our acquisition process was designed by Al-Qaeda, but I think that we have to have that agility as warfighters to be able to necessarily stay ahead of technology.
Lauren?
Okay, so this is a
one rule, by the way.
This is
a
non-traditional answer, so that's just me thinking different. So here's what I would change. It's not really a rule, but here's what drives me crazy. Okay, so I look at my peers, and we are schedule-driven beyond belief. And we are driven from meeting to meeting to meeting. And every meeting, there is a PowerPoint that drives the meeting, and it makes my head explode. So here's what I would challenge. I would challenge the mentality in the building and probably in some of the staffs in the fleet that says you have got to have a PowerPoint read ahead for every meeting. If I am coming to you and I am going to request a decision from you, I owe you a read ahead. I owe you the time to have your staff prep it and tell you, you know, what the pros and cons are. But if I'm coming to just talk about what I think the future of whatever is, let's have a conversation. And let's not have it driven by our staffs. I think we unfortunately, because we are so schedule-driven, we tend to abdicate a lot of these preparations, these, quite frankly, some of our thinking to our staffs, and I think that's a problem. I think that we as flag officers and senior executives in the building and the senior leaders in your organizations, we ought to be having conversations with one another just because we can. And because I think that would open the white space in our brains and allow us to think about things differently. When you go into a meeting and you're handed a PowerPoint, it totally drives the way you think and the way you act. And it's not productive. And quite frankly, I think it's a deviance, you know, it's driving our behavior downwards in a bad way. When you go into a meeting and you're challenged and you're able to actually think and ask questions and have a real dialogue, you come up with some real insightful answers that you probably would not have thought of without that PowerPoint stuck in front of you. So that's what I would change. It's not a rule per se, but it might as well be, because that's kind of the way we always do it.
Okay, so I wrote down Lauren Selby, Pentagon, no PowerPoint, heretic.
And I'll own it, though, just the
one. Jim?
Okay, well, the rule that comes to mind for me is one that is enshrined in many organizations, and certainly at NASA, we're still on tape, so I won't give you the original version, but it goes something like, if one guy or gal makes a mess, then everybody has to wear diapers. What we do is we don't allow for, I guess, human nature. We don't allow that people are going to make mistakes, some of them intentionally, some of them unintentionally, and we try to legislate, process out the possibility of people making mistakes because one person did once. And so I think that is an area where if we could tolerate a bit of that, because there's always going to be people who speed on the highways, so we put policemen out there to collect money for their municipality. We need to do the same thing, I think, in government, and that is to not try to legislate, because we all know no fraud, waste, or abuse, right? However, it turns out, in order to avoid any fraud or abuse, you waste an incredible amount. Thank you.
Easy for me to say because I'm not actually in the Navy, but the rule I would change is the difference in the way we approach problem set and information communication between an operational staff at war and a headquarters staff. And I've watched time and time again, whether it's General Mattis, come and say, look, anyone who's got a good idea, come here. You as leaders, protect your mavericks, listen to their voices. When I get inside the Pentagon, I hear, okay, so we're gonna staff this, and anyone senior to the most junior guy who texts the tasker can change the delivery, can change the message, can stop it from going forward, can take away the insights and package it for consumption. And that rule set that we use is I think, preventing us from maintaining any velocity that is anything but the curve you just described.
Okay, so there's another example. You remember, I'm the director of the Navy staff. Okay, I'm starting to feel a little bit of hostility up here at the panel. Okay, Steve.
Yeah, so speaking from the academic perspective, I'd get rid of the forced curve. And here's what I mean by that. Let's say we're giving people an educational experience. It could be in a classroom, traditional, or through the cloud, or practical problem solving, whatever it is. We're giving a group of people that experience because we believe that there's some skills and some knowledge they should end with that are important for them going forward. And then what do? We make a fixed investment, a homogeneous investment, in a group of people who are not homogeneous. And then we're shocked at the end that there are some people who get A's, B's, and C's. Well, whose fault is that, right? Because what we did is we didn't tailor our delivery for the idiosyncrasies of the individual to get everyone to an A. And so what we've done is we've put the blame and the burden on the student who doesn't quite fit into that pathway to accept the C. And the guy who gets the A, you could say it's talent, but I'd say a big part of it is just dumb luck, you know, pun and deliberate, that person just happened to fit into that means of learning and so excelled, and the B's and the C's didn't fit as well. So if we dump the forced curve, we put the burden and the responsibility back on the instructor to actually figure out the student and the pathway that student should take to get to an A level of acquisition of the skills and the knowledge. So forced curve, you're dead to me.
Okay. Admiral Vitale asked a great question, and the way he framed it was a perfect way to wrap this up. You know, you look at the rule set, and the CNO has been very, very emphatic about this. When we rolled out the design last January, And as you've read it, and all of you, it just appears about all of you have read it, which is fantastic. And as I look at that design, this high-velocity learning line of effort, he calls for fractal behavior, you know, that, hey, everything should kind of repeat image throughout the organization from engine room lower level, you know, from the top down to engine room lower level on that amphibious ship. He's also been very, very resistant to, you know, Robert Thomas and his view of implementation, which is that typical operator view, which is, okay, there's the objective. I will go through a deliberate planning process. I will do mission analysis. Here's my plan org. Next is my exord, and then we move out. He refuses to allow us to generate what he calls a high-velocity learning kit. You know, this notion that we're going to mail out a box. It's probably be green because of the green LOE, and it's going to just show up on every unit's doorstep, and here's your HVL kit. But back to Admiral Vitale's point, as far as implementation, it's clear in all the conversations and all the debates we've had so far and the efforts that are going on out in many organizations in the Navy that the center of gravity, and it's not going to shock anybody here, are those unit commanding officers. And the unit commanding officer may be small unit tactics, that squad leader. It may be, Admiral Hilardi's, the commander of Naval Sea Systems Command, or G8 over at Nav Air. It's those unit commanding officers, and we have to get them to embrace the culture change. And this is not easy stuff. If this was an easy problem, it already would have been solved. Brenda Opperman is out there. Rob Marshall is there in the audience. They're involved with me in trying to make this change, implement this change in the Navy, as are a lot of the panel members here. We're going to debate it again on Thursday. We're gathering all the Navy flag officer and senior executives, Department of the Navy, and we're going to hash this one out again. The CNO has been extremely patient and actually has been embracing and inclusive and, I'll be honest with you, a very healthy debate about implementation of high-velocity learning. But again, the center of gravity is the commanding officers. If I have my way, we will have essentially a tribe of change agents go out and convince commanding officer by commanding officer of this cultural change. And many of them, frankly, already get it. And we're going to go out, and I'll bet you we learn from them as we go out and see what they're doing. Okay, thanks again, everybody. Really thank you, panel members, for a great discussion.